It gives me great pleasure to introduce Professor Brigitte Farrew, who's a professor in pulmonology, and she's head of the Paediatric and Non-Invasive Ventilation and Sleep Unit at the Necker University Hospital in Paris, France.
Professor Farrew, if you wouldn't mind just setting the scene with regards to what is CPAP and what is non-invasive ventilation?
Dear Mrs. Chatwin, thank you very much for your introduction. Yes, to understand how CPAP and non-invasive ventilation works, it's important to understand the normal respiratory balance. Indeed, the normal respiratory balance has three components. The first component is the central drive, who normally drive the respiratory muscles. In a healthy subject, the respiratory muscles are strong and are able to make the air enter the lungs. Why? Because the respiratory load imposed on the respiratory system is very low. So it's very easy for strong and normal respiratory muscles to overcome the work of breathing and to make the subject breathe normally. However, as you can see on the figure on the left, there are some disorders that are responsible for a disruption of the respiratory balance. And these disorders can concern either the central drive, the respiratory muscles, or the respiratory system. So one of the most common respiratory disturbance is the weakness of the respiratory muscles, as we can observe in patients with neuromuscular disease. In this case, the central drive drives the respiratory muscles, but they are too weak to overcome the load of the respiratory load of the respiratory system, which has as a consequence a decrease in the tidal volume. The other type of disorders are disorders characterized by an increase in respiratory load. This is observed in children having upper airway obstruction because in this situation, the inspiratory pressure necessary to overcome the resistance of the upper airways is extremely high. Another type of disorders are lung disorders such as cystic fibrosis or bronchopulmonary dysplasia, which are characterized also by an increase in the work of breathing due to an increase in the peripheral resistance of the airway. And then there is a third type of disorders, which is much more uncommon. It are disorders characterized by an abnormality of central drive. One of the most well-known disorders in children, however very rare, is congenital central hypoventilation or Ondine's course. In this disease, the respiratory muscles are normal, the respiratory system is normal, but the brain doesn't drive correctly the respiratory muscles. However, whatever the type of disequilibrium, the resultant consequence is a decrease in tidal volume and minute ventilation. And then it is the role from non-invasive ventilation to normalize the respiratory balance. How? Either by replacing central drive, either by supporting or replacing weakened respiratory muscles, or either by decreasing the respiratory load. In case of upper airway obstruction, patients will need CPAP because simply by opening the airways, the non-invasive ventilation will be able to normalize the work of breathing. In children with bronchopulmonary dysplasia, CPAP may also be very useful to overcome the intrinsic expiratory pressure, and in cystic fibrosis, NIV will support the respiratory muscles to maintain a sufficient tidal volume. So here you can see represented the principle of CPAP. You see here a figure of the airways with the upper drawing on the figure in the middle, showing normal breathing with airways that are completely and normally open. Then you can have a moderate reduction of the airways by a moderate closure of the upper airways, which only results in a limitation of the inspiratory flow without any consequence, neither desaturation, neither microarousal. However, if the flow decreases to more than 30% of the normal baseline airflow and is associated with a desaturation or a microarousal, then the respiratory event will be scored as an hypopnea. In the most serious situation, there will be an apnea if the airflow is reduced to more than 90% of the normal airflow. And what will be the aim of CPAP? It will be to open the airway by delivering a constant pressure through the entire breathing cycle. You can see that on the figure on the left, where you see here normal breathing. And here you see the normal breathing of a child above a certain positive airway pressure, which is necessary to maintain the airways open. And you can see here that it's a very simple mode of ventilation where you have a constant airflow with a calibrated leak to allow the exhalation of the expired carbon dioxide during expiration. Here you see represented the principle of NIV. In NIV, here you see first a patient as a subject breathing normally. You can see that the contraction of the diaphragm and the accessory inspiratory muscles is responsible of a negative intrathoracic pressure, a small positive gastric pressure, and a positive transdiaphragmatic pressure. And you can see that here on the diaphragmatic electromyogram, where you see that you have a contraction of the diaphragm. This contraction of the diaphragm is responsible of the entry in the lung of a normal physiological tidal volume. When the patient is supported by NIV, the ventilator delivers a certain pressure in the airway, which with a consequence that it replaces or reduces the contraction, the effort, the activity of the diaphragm, and that it is associated with an increase in tidal volume. So you see that this type of ventilation is much more complicated than simple CPAP, because the ventilator has to detect the onset of the inspiration of the patient, represented here by the blue tracing of the esophageal or intrathoracic pressure. Then the ventilator has to react very rapidly to deliver a sufficient positive pressure enough to stop the contraction of the inspiratory muscles. Then the patient can inspire normally. And also the ventilator has to detect the end of the inspiration in order to allow the patient to exhale. And you can see that this is based on a decrease, on a threshold decrease of the inspiratory flow. Then the ventilator knows that the patient has finished his inspiration and he allows here the patient to exhale spontaneously.